So, Vete Omnes, today we're looking at the story on the history lecture on Romulus, the king, and how in his first actions as king of Rome, and how he became king. So here we go. Now, the story goes that Romulus and Livy left the city of Alba Longa and left their grandfather, Numitor, who they had restored to the throne, in charge of the city, and went out to find a new settlement. They took all their friends and people who wanted to leave the city so they could start over, and they decided to found a city where they were exposed as children. The spot, or a spot, near the river Tiber, surrounded by seven hills. The hills you might have heard of, the Palatine, the Aventine, Capitoline, and so forth. Now the question was, who would be king? Since they were twins, the question of seniority was precluded. They didn't know who was the oldest, so they couldn't choose the oldest person to become king. They decided to have the will of the gods determined by augury. As good proto-Romans, they decided to conduct an auspicium. Now, an auspicium is a way to figure out the will of the gods by watching birds. The word auspicium literally means bird watching. The first part of the word comes from avis, that means bird, and then spicium means sea. So they both went up to neighboring hills and watched the sky. Remus went to the Aventine and then promptly came down and let the people know that he saw six vultures. Romulus went to the Palatine Hill and let the people know he saw double the amount of vultures. And then all the people who supported Romulus, the people who supported Remus, ran down from the hills and met in the spot where today is the Circus Maximus, the place where they hold chariot races. Here's a cool picture of them looking at the birds. On the left is Remus, and on the right is Romulus. You can see six birds flying over Remus's head, and then hopefully there's 12 birds, 12 vultures flying over Romulus's head. And you can see they both have their friends with them. And this is an engraving by Giovanni Battista Fontana that we've seen pick some of these other engravings in the earlier lectures. People cheered Romulus and cheered him as king. People cheered on Remus and cheered him as king. And they started, the two groups arguing where the Circus Maximus is today, started arguing first with words, and then the words led, and then it led to blows. And then in the fight, suddenly Remus died. How he died, who killed them, people don't know. He just died in the fight. And then Romulus became king with his brother having passed. Now there's a second story of how Remus died that is more common. And the story goes that Remus was jeering his brother by jumping over his half-built walls of his settlement on the Palatine Hill. He was saying how small Romulus's walls were. Romulus did not handle the jeering well and became enraged, took out his sword, and killed his brother. And then added the threat, "So perish whoever else shall overleap my battlements." But either way, Romulus est rex. He is now king. His first act was to fortify the Palatine Hill and name the city after himself. And here's another engraving by Fontana, and it has a great little inscription on it. So go ahead and write this down. It says, "Sublato fratre Romulus initia urbs locat eamque a suo nomine appellat Roma." With the brother having been taken away, Romulus placed the beginnings of the city, initia urbis, eamque appellat. So he had to go to appellat, and he called it a suo nomine, from his name, Rome, or Roma. And it's a cool picture. You can see Romulus directing people, digging ditches, building walls, doing what needs to be done. Then, deinde Romulus sacrificat Hercule. Then Romulus sacrificed to Hercules and the other gods. Now, when he sacrificed the gods, he used the Alban forms, except for Hercules, where he followed the Greek ritual instituted by Evander, the king of ancient Palatium. So one thing that Roman historians love to do is they love to explain why certain sacrifices are done in such a way, why certain things are, you know, certain cultural practices, why is something called this? And this is an explanation of why in Rome, when they sacrifice to Hercules, they sacrifice in the Greek fashion. So this special sacrifice goes back to the story about Hercules in the area around Rome called ancient Palatium. Supposedly, before Roman historians got there, there had been another city there ruled by a guy named Evander. And by the time Romulus and Remus were there, it was gone. Now, while completing a labor, Hercules was driving the oxen of Geryon close to the Tiber River. So Hercules was completing a labor where he grabbed this oxen from a guy named Geryon who lived far to the west. Geryon, by the way, was Medusa's grandson, who had three bodies and one head, or in other stories, had one body and three heads. But he had this special cattle that Hercules had to get and bring back to Greece. And on his way there, Hercules stopped near the Tiber River so they could get some water and so he could keep going to Greece. Hercules fell asleep while the oxen were getting their water. And a giant that lived nearby, a guy named Calchas, and in some story he breathes fire and smoke and was super strong. So, but whatever happened, Calchas, or however you want to describe Calchas, taken by the beauty of the oxen, stole some of them by pulling them by their tail into his nearby cave. When Hercules awoke and noticed that the oxen were missing, he went to the nearest cave looking for them. Hercules was perplexed when he saw the footprints leading out of the cave because they were being dragged back in by their tail. As Hercules was walking away from the cave, he heard the oxen moo. Moo-gio! He turned around and walked towards the cave. Then Calchas attacked Hercules, but Hercules struck him with his club and Calchas fell dead. And here's a cool picture of Hercules doing this from the 16th century. At this time, Evander, who was in charge of this part of the country, held sway because of his ability to write letters, and his mother was also revered as a prophetess. The locals swarmed Hercules, and then after he had dispatched Calchas, and Evander came over to greet him. Evander, recognizing Hercules more than a man, approached him and told him that his mother had prophesied that a great man would increase the number of the gods. Then Evander held a sacrifice of a splendid beast from Hercules' herd and sacrificed one of the cows to Hercules as a future deity. And then he said two distinguished families in the area, the Potii and the Pinarii, were going to take care of these sacrifices in perpetuity. The Potii were on time and were served the entrails of the sacrifice, and the Pinarii were late and served a remainder. Throughout history, the sacrifice of Hercules was performed by the Potii, and the Pinarii at the ceremony would not be served entrails. So this explained why the certain sacrifice is done such a way in ancient Rome, and why does it work this way? So it was, again, trying to explain some cultural practices of Rome. The point was, this was the only foreign religious rite adopted by Romulus and still held in Rome. And by doing so, Romulus also showed his respect for that immortality, which was a prize of valor. And also it foreshadowed that Romulus' own destiny was already leading him to the same reward, trying to associate Romulus with Hercules. After Romulus performing his proper religious duties, he summoned his subjects and gave them laws as a good king. Romulus believed that his subjects would only respect the law if he adopted visible signs of power. He had 12 lictors or bodyguards to follow him, so he created these group of bodyguards called the lictors. The number 12 was chosen either because Romulus saw 12 vultures or from some Etruscan origin. Now, these lictors continued into historical times in Rome. They would vary in number depending on what political office you held, and they would carry a thing called the fasces, which are a bundle of rods with an axe in it, and this signifies the power of the state, because you could beat people with the rods or kill them with the axe. Later on, this was appropriated by the fascists in Italy as their symbol. And the word fascism comes from the word fasces. Romulus also named 100 senators as head of the clans and called them patres. Their descendants would be called the patricians. So these senators would help advise the king in times of, for everything. And you can see here's Romulus on the left, and you have his lictors around him, and then the rest of the people in here are the senators. In order to increase the population of Rome, Rome accepted homeless and destitute folk and pretended that they were born of the earth. So Romulus increased the population by accepting people from all over Italy. Romulus also opened up the land by the capital line to fugitives. The new population was a ragtag and bobtail from the neighboring peoples, some free, some slave, and all of them wanting nothing but a fresh start. Now the problem was, these are mostly men. And there's a story called, the story that the Romans talk about called, what we call today, the abduction of the Sabine women, where they stole women from the neighboring peoples because they could not have, they were not able to get women to increase their population and to continue their society for another generation. Rome was now a strong city that could challenge any of its neighbors, but this could only last for a single generation because of the lack of women. Rome sent envoys to the neighboring cities asking for women to intermarry. The neighboring cities, both fearing and despising Rome, refused the offers and made jibes that the Romans opened their gates to female runaways and vagabonds because those were the women that the Romans deserved. Insidiae. Treachery. The Romans invited their neighbors to the Consualia, a solemn feast in honor of Neptune, patron of the horse. The Romans promoted the event and put on a wonderful spectacle. The people from the towns of Caenium, Crustinium, and Antimaniae, and the whole Sabine people came. So it was basically a giant open house that everyone in the neighboring area could come and see what Rome looks like and also participate in this festival. As the festival proceeded, Romulus gave a signal and the Romans seized only supposedly, and again, this is written by a man trying to explain a difficult story that's part of their history, and said only the unmarried women were seized. One woman was given to a senator named Thalassius, and so she was being carried away from the gang. The gang said Thalassio, Thalassio, which is often said at Roman weddings. So he's using this to explain where various cultural practices come from. The parents escaped, but not before saying bitter comments and heartfelt prayers to the gods. The parents and the daughters felt grossly deceived. The young women were indignant and full of foreboding for the future. The aftermath. Romulus was able to reassure the frightened women and blame their parents for not allowing them to intermarry. Romulus said that the Romans would make the women a part of their community and seal with the deepest bond, the bond of children. Romulus urged them to forget their wrath and give their hearts to those to whom chance had given their bodies. And that's a direct quote from Livy. And then the Romans spoke honeyed words and vowed that it was passionate love which prompted their offense. Livy then said, "No plea can better touch a woman's heart." Now, there's a lot of problems with this description of this abduction. And it's a thing that we'll talk about more in class. All right. Valete omnes lingua latina est vita.